Thank you very much. My name is John Ottman. I'm, as Deborah mentioned, Executive Chairman of Solix Technologies. I want to take you through just a few top-line context-building points here, and then hopefully we'll have Noel's line open, and then he'll be presenting. And we'll try to save some time at the very end for some of your questions. Next page, please, Deborah. Okay, just real quickly, Solix Technologies, in case you're not familiar with who we are, we were founded in 2002. We're headquartered in Santa Clara, California. And our line of focus is enterprise data management. I want to talk a little bit about that and exactly what that is. We are an OEM to Oracle for their FlexCube universal banking system. We offer our solutions in many ways, traditional perpetual licenses, subscription licenses, free download licenses, and we also have a pre-built appliance, which we call Solix XApps appliance, and also all these services are delivered through the Solix Cloud as well. Now, if you take a look at enterprise data management, or what the industry calls enterprise data management, it really focuses on four key application areas for infrastructure management of structured data. The first is database archiving. Many of us think of this as information lifecycle management, or managing data growth. But the reason why people archive is because the performance of structured database applications such as an Oracle E-Business, PeopleSoft, Siebel type of application, the performance is dramatically impacted by the amount of data that you're processing. And if you're able to reduce the data set, you're able to significantly improve performance, significantly improve your batch processing capabilities, make upgrades easier because you're not going to be converting data that would cause extensive outages, et cetera. So database archiving, really sort of a staple out there in the infrastructure software space. Database masking is another key area. This is for non-production data to be able to obfuscate or de-identify sensitive data. This is obviously critical for key compliance guidelines such as PCI and NIST requirements in the government and whatnot. And then application retirement is another key area of data management. Gartner Group has suggested that huge amounts of something like 40% of all enterprise data in a data center is obsolete, running on obsolete systems that should be retired. And the question is, how do you retire these systems? What's the best way to approach this? And Noel's going to go into this area in some additional detail as well and talk about the significant cost reduction opportunity that exists there. Test data management is the fourth key area of enterprise data management, and what we're really talking about here is creating database subsets. Let's say, for instance, you're running a PeopleSoft application and you have to run a training class for some new users. Typically, the database administrator is going to be requested to create an instance of the application for just the training. Now, if it's a large-scale database, creating a full instance for just a training exercise can be a big job and really not almost worth the effort. But if you're able to very quickly snap off a subset of that database, you can take a very long and difficult cloning process and reduce it to really a much easier to manage process to be able to get your data up quickly and in good shape for your users on Monday morning. Now, test data management is also very significant when it comes to reducing your non-production storage footprint, because it's really not necessary to completely clone your database for all of your non-production uses. And if you can subset your databases instead of cloning, estimates are, I think Noel has estimated, that you can get up to 80% savings in your non-production storage environments. So those are the four key areas of enterprise data management. And the Solix Cloud is one way to deliver it if you don't want to run it in-house. And essentially, this is where we're going to run enterprise data management as a service. You can sign up for the cloud and just really attach to these services. Or you can deploy it in your own private cloud in a similar architecture. Managed services are also available for these solutions that if you want to just have these software services running and have somebody come in on a monthly basis and operate it for you, that's available not just from Solix but also from several Solix partners. Next slide, please, Deborah. So here's an example of a good area of enterprise data management. Now, you know, database masking and test data management are often integrated together into a process that we call masking on the fly. And it's interesting, and I think Noel is going to have some statistics on this, that something like 25% only of enterprises out there are actually using data masking software to mask their non-production sensitive data, which is really very, very surprising, particularly in this day and age of hacking disasters appearing regularly on the front pages and significant compliance guidelines and even fines and customer perception issues that are the result of being hacked. You would think that more people would be masking their data, and we're wondering why not, and we're thinking, you know, that obviously you know, everybody wants to have their data protected, but perhaps the high cost and perhaps the complexity of the project is preventing people from properly securing their non-production data. Here's an example. If you look at the test data management lifecycle, let's say you're creating a development instance of a database, the first thing you want to do to make sure that instance is properly masked is you want to go in and discover all the sensitive data that's in that database, because it may not always be intuitively obvious, and we have an automated discovery tool that can do that. Then you might subset the database to make it into a more manageable size. And then once it's subsetted, then you might mask it and actually obfuscate the sensitive data into syntactically accurate representations of the data, but actually not the same data. And then as you go through and refresh and go through your test cycle and you go through validation to understand, okay, has my development process been successful or not, you can see that discover, subset, mask, validating your results critical to the test management, test data management lifecycle approach. You know, there's key areas in here where tool sets can be utilized, which are available on a free download from Solix, and to really get after this this cost issue, which is what we're assuming is one of the key barriers to broader adoption of database masking solutions. So, very typical example of subsetting and masking on the fly. Next slide, please, Deborah. So also today, an important announcement from Solix. We have announced a free download version, is what we call standard edition, of our database archiving software. We call standard edition. So Solix products exist in two versions: an enterprise edition, which is that you pay for, and the standard edition, which is a free download. So big announcement from us today that free database masking is now available from Solix, and you can go directly to our website, solix.com, and you'll see there, you know, how to get into our standard edition environment. Next slide, please, Deborah. Just a quick customer list. You know, I don't want to go into any of these, but I just want you to understand that Solix has been out there for quite a while, and we've got a very extensive install base and very extensive amount of experience in this area across almost all industries and in almost all countries around the world.
And thanks for joining us on this webinar. My name is Noel Yuhanna, Principal Analyst with Forrester Research. And I guess I'm going to talk about today is enterprise data management on a zero-based budget. This is a very interesting topic, actually, if you know, because data management itself is actually a very interesting topic, you know. And then we talk about many zero-based budget, you know, how do you kind of roll this up? It's a lot of challenging right now where budgets are not really growing significantly. And people actually aren't really investing as much in software, right? So typically the budget we have done in the past is where we have actually, you know, spent whatever we had spent last year, and the budget is going to be increasing the last year's spending. But zero-based budget is all about reassessing your programs from zero-based environment. You know, if at all you were to start from scratch, okay, what do you have to consider of changing your software, your solutions, your architectures, your data management, and that's what this is all about, actually, the zero-based budget. And I think all organizations should be looking into having this program. Next slide. So the key trends, what we see is, you know, the data volumes are growing. Most organizations I speak to have running into terabytes of data. They're heading well into petabytes, and this creates a manageability issue, performance issues, and what have you. Enterprises have thousands of databases. In fact, I was speaking to one financial services company. They have more than 50,000 databases, and that's huge. When you have 50,000 databases, trying to manage them could be a nightmare, actually. Compliance pressure continues. You have PCI regulations, HIPAA regulations, all of these. And even the Fortune 100 companies I speak to on a regular basis still struggle with compliances. It's not just the smaller organizations or the mid-size. Even the largest of the largest corporations have an issue. Lack of staffing issues, you know, I mean, I think every organization is struggling with that and having a staffing kind of concern, you know, right? You're increasing the number of databases and applications, but I guess it's a challenge itself as to the staff hasn't grown, actually, right? So you got to do more with less now, actually, which I think is definitely an issue. Also, budget issues I talked about as well. And having optimized systems today, I think it's critical. There's demand for having optimized systems, each efficient systems to ensure customer satisfaction, deliver competitive advantage is definitely critical. Next slide. So if you look at the various challenges in the enterprises, you know, lack of system resources, security, lack of people resources, which do you think are in the priority in terms of the most challenging of these? Is it securing data, performance issues, data volume growth, people resources, or system resources? We'll see that in the next slide. In the next slide, you'll see that performance is definitely the most challenging of the all. 80% of the people struggle with performance, and this is not surprising. We have been doing survey for the last 10 years. Performance consistently comes as a number one issue. And why? Well, it's a data volume issue, I guess, you know. More applications, more databases, more environments, complex environments. Then you got people resource issues, you got availability issues, volume growth, and database security issues as well. Next slide. If you look at database management functions or data management functions, they can be broken down into many different topics, you know, from data security to data governance, quality, architecture, archiving on database, data warehouse as well. And each of these could actually lend by itself a full discussion for the day talking about these things. But, you know, I think more important is like data archiving. You know, a lot could be improved on data archiving. And people think, why is archiving important? Well, if your data volume is growing, you want to reduce the size of your databases. The bigger the size of the database, the more you're going to spend on the hardware. In fact, we have seen organizations who spend archiving solutions can save money, actually. Why? Because the fact that you can reduce the size of the database quite a lot, and that means you can defer the hardware upgrades, which you normally do every 2-3 years. You can do it every 4 years, maybe, or 5 years. You know, you can defer them. So this can save you a lot of money, actually. Plus, also, it can really improve the management, the upgrades, and all of the performance of the application as well. And also, if you look at automation, I think it really helps you as well. Masking, I think, is another critical component, which John talked about. I think this is an area which organizations actually should be improving their test environments, their dev environments, making sure they're meeting the compliance and regulations, actually, as well. So this is an important area which I think organizations should be investing further in. Next slide. Now, if you look at the trends, the new applications are demanding faster data access and support for these applications and users, right? We have new mobile applications, social networking applications, predictive analytics, and all of these good stuff. Well, how do you optimize applications when your data issues are still existing, right? I mean, how do you go about doing this, right? This is one of the biggest issues. And you know, traditionally, we have built applications every year, a few in every year. Now we are building applications every week. So when you're building these new applications every week, how do you ensure that the data management layer is most efficient, right? This becomes very, very critical. People forget that data management is a very important critical asset to an organization, but very also important to deliver performance and scale and integration and what have you as well. Next slide. Now, if you look at the benefits if you have of a tuned and optimized data management platform, it's huge. You can have defer hardware upgrade. As I mentioned, people who are doing having an optimized data management platform, such as doing archiving and having it optimized, typically can save 20% or more on data management budgets, actually, right? And some actually have saved 65%, right? You have to actually make that initiative and call to start to doing something on data management to really improve its functionality. It increases revenue. You can add more customers, right? I mean, because you can run more efficient data management, you can build more powerful applications sitting on top of that, which makes it a lot difference. Increases customer satisfaction. It makes IT more productive. I think this is a very critical component where people actually, when you have optimized systems, tend to get more optimized in terms of the application, but also makes IT very, very productive. This is some of the things which we've seen. Next slide. Now, data archiving has become critical for all enterprises. And I think, you know, archiving, if you look at it, we have obviously traditional CRM and ERP and other applications. And I think archiving, everyone should doing the archiving platform because, you know, at the end of the day, you don't need all this data. And I think John was mentioning about this as well, that you have all this old data sets which is lying there. And why do you have to actually put this into production, actually? Right? This could be 10-year-old data, 5-year-old data sitting there. You can actually move that offline, actually, or even to a less-cost servers, right? And this is where archiving comes in. Next slide. Now, data archiving offers many use cases. If you look at it, it can lower your cost, it can improve efficiencies, it can actually improve compliances, reporting. It's not just about retention of data. People think, well, data archiving is just removing data and just keeping it for long-term retention. Well, not. It can do lots and lots of things, I guess, right? It can do e-discovery, it can do data recovery, it can do data integration, it can be reporting. You actually create a tiered architecture. You can really move this data into another platform, which I think is critical for organizations to operate. Next slide. Now, if you look at in this whole, the adoption of archiving, right? If you look at the last 10 years, how the adoption of archiving has been, well, today it's about 37% adoption. About a third of the organizations in the world are doing database data archiving for their critical systems and applications, right? And you know, question is, you know, why? And question is, you know, if you aren't doing it, guess what? You're paying more for your hardware. more for your software. The bigger the database you're running, you're paying additional price for the CPU, the memory, the disk IOs, and all those things going on. As you know it, if you probably are familiar with systems, a smaller, lean architecture is more efficient. So this is actually is interesting that a lot of people haven't even started in archiving. And this whole adoption hasn't even doubled over the last decade in terms of archiving. So I think it's something to consider for your organization, I would say, is to think about archiving. It's just that, you know, what are the end results of archiving? Sometimes it's not visible, right? Like applications you build, you can see the application. With archiving, you may not be able to see the results, right? But guess what? If you tell the management and if you look at the result savings in terms of cost savings, in terms of the more efficiencies, I think it's pretty powerful actually right there. Next slide. Let's talk about security as well. Now, if you look at in a traditional data management environment, you'd have in production, which is on the left-hand side, you'll see data in motion encryption, you will see auditing, you'll see data at rest encryption. And on the right-hand side, which is more the test and dev environment, you'll see the masking is very critical as well. And this is actually the whole approach for database management systems, where you want to have a better facility of doing masking of these environments as well. So I think masking has become very important. It's basically de-identifying sensitive data, especially for critical data sets, for PII, PHI protection. But also when you're doing offshore development, you want to mask certain elements. We have seen a lot of healthcare organizations and insurance companies now starting to do that, which I think is good for in general. Next slide. Now, if the data protection is critical, why is the adoption of masking slow, right? I mean, if you look at the masking about a decade ago, it was about 12%. Today, it's about 25%. Well, this is, by the way, this stats is more for general adoption across all vertical industries. Now, if we were to slice and dice this data for financial services companies and insurance companies and healthcare, we probably will see maybe a lot higher, you know, like maybe 40, 50%. But this is across the board. Now, question is, you know, if it's critical, why aren't people doing masking, right? Well, they think, well, it's not something which is obviously, is essential, right? Basically, databases, if you're not doing it, databases are vulnerable, right? I mean, database, anyone could hack into it. People don't realize that if someone breaks into your database, production database is where most of the focus is. But guess what? If you make a copy of production, even the test environments and dev environments are vulnerable. In fact, we see a lot of customers complaining today about breaking into the test environments and dev environments. And guess what? The DBAs and security officers are not even looking at those test and dev environments. So I think organizations should seriously consider putting masking in place, not only just to secure the environments, but also to meet the compliances, right? The PCI regulations, the HIPAA regulations, and what have you, right? And I think this is an area which I think will be critical, which is important. Now, the people who are doing masking, actually, right, a lot of people are writing scripts. and scripts can be done. It's not like rocket science that you can't do the scripts for masking. But the problem is they can't scale. They can't automate this. And they're not even reliable. We have seen a lot of companies do this for one or two applications, which is fine. But when you start to do 10 applications or maybe 100, well, forget it, right? You're going to spend a lot of like a team of consultants or employees. It becomes a bigger project. You're going to spend more money trying to do scripts by yourself than getting an automated solution as such. Next slide. So I guess, you know, why have enterprises not invested into data management technologies like archiving and masking and all of these things, right? What have been the issues? Next slide. I guess, you know, one of the things what we have seen is that the budget issue remains, right? I mean, IT purchases have been slowly growing. And obviously, you don't really have those additional budget to buy every software on the planet, right? You only could buy so much, right? And if you look at the IT purchases in this graph, which shows you the last 3-4 years of expenditure, you know, IT has grown about 5-6% on an average, right? And if you look at the total IT purchases in 2013, it's going to be $2 trillion. $2 trillion is what IT is going to spend worldwide on the entire hardware and software and consulting services, $2 trillion. Software alone is $500 billion of this, right? Now, some of these things are budgeted over the last decade. like you spent, you know, maybe on databases, you know, last year. Let's put another 5% more on databases to get to this year as well. But guess what? You should actually also consider some of these new initiatives, like data management initiatives, which can really improve the efficiencies. I think this is where organizations really need to rethink their strategies about how they're going to spend this budget. Next slide. This is a very interesting slide where we see the U.S. tech investment hasn't grown significantly, right? It's 2-3%. Yet, your average data growth has increased significantly every quarter, and there's no stopping here. If you don't act now, I guess what is going to happen, you're going to really have a bigger issue, and you're going to spend more money in the long run trying to fix that issue. Basically, you know, we see about 20% now to about 40% growth of data every quarter. Why? Because this is not only about structured data, but also unstructured data and semi-structured data, which we are dealing with, right? So this is, I think, becoming a bigger issue. And I think this is a time for organizations to just have a wake-up call to start to think about data management in a better and more broader sense that can actually improve the whole application delivery. Next slide. So I guess the top 5 reasons why data management solutions adoption has been slow is a couple of these, right? Well, we got budget issues. It's impacting most enterprises. We talked about the budget issues, right? There's definitely lots of budget issue going on today. And I think this is where the zero-based budget comes in. You don't really have to, just because you spent last year 10% on this software, you need to spend 15% on that same software again this year. Maybe not. Maybe you have to think back and see what are the options available for me in terms of doing a better job in my whole application delivery, my whole data management framework, right? Staffing issues, I guess, doing with more with less is also one of the reasons why the data management solution adoption has been slower, right? Justifying ROI to the top management has become very challenging. And often, I think this is an area which I think is a critical component, right? Because how do you justify the ROI to top management? I think people think, well, the management says, well, we got other things to consider, like mobile platforms and cloud platforms and other strategies like tablets, right? I mean, but yeah, you actually, sometimes the management, top management doesn't see the value of data management because they can't really see the value, so to speak. Like application, as I mentioned, you can see an application deployed on mobile. That's what management can see. It's running on their iPhones, but data management, they don't see it. And I think this is where I think you guys come in. You guys come in to tell the management of some of the benefits you can actually achieve around data management in terms of cost savings, in terms of ROI, in terms of productivity benefits. Homegrown scripts, I think, are one of the reasons why data management solutions haven't grown significantly in terms of adoption. Just because, you know, these scripts are there, has been there for decades, right? And they haven't been broken yet. and you know, the biggest problem, I think, is scale and the reliability of these scripts, actually, you know. I speak to about 2 to 3 customers every day. And you know, when I speak to these customers, I guess, you know, they're saying, yeah, scripts are still running fine, actually. But they are having more issues with tuning and optimization of these scripts because they can't scale as much, you know, and they're running into issues. And when they have a new version coming out, that's another bigger challenge, right? And what have you. And also other IT priorities obviously creates a bigger issue for organizations. Next slide. So I guess, you know, what are the choices exist to support an improved and efficient data management platform? Well, traditionally, we have been doing commercial software for decades, right? And then obviously more recently, open source software kicked in, right? Almost like a decade ago, more than a decade ago, and that's been good. So what's next, right? I mean, like, where do we go from here? Do we start to use open source in a big way, or where do we go from here? Because, you know, we don't really have a big budget here of $10 billion trying to spend on data management, maybe. How do you go about doing this? Next slide. So let's look at the software licensing models, right? Next slide. It's a build-up, actually. There will be four. Next slide. Next. Thanks. Okay, so here, if you look at the four things, if you go back and one, next. Okay, if you look at these four things here, you got commercial, which can be very expensive, advanced features, full support, frequent releases, no limit on paid usage. It's actually things like which you buy from Oracle, Microsoft, and all. You know, these are commercial products which has been there for decades. It's expensive, but it's got advanced features. It's full supported and everything, good thing. Open source, on the other hand, is lower cost, right? It's comprehensive features, restriction on usage. Sometimes you provide restrictions about if you want to use open source, you have to have include the copyright and all those things. There's optional commercial support available for open source. It's regularly released. It's high adoption like Linux and MySQL. The newer models which have now emerged have been subscription model, which is pay as you go. No upfront cost, advanced features, full supported, frequent releases, no limit on paid usages. It's variable adoption. It's actually things like when Amazon EC2, SaaS, and others, where you don't really have to spend millions of dollars trying to get onto Amazon or SaaS, like Salesforce and what have you. You pay as you go. If you don't want to pay next month, that's fine. You don't use the software next month, right? I mean, it's a subscription model. It's pretty cool. It's more about OPEX than CAPEX. Free software, which is called freemium. You know, it's a free but premium software. It's not something which is best by free. It's not a trial version. It's a free version. It's zero cost. It's got most features. It's got limited free usages. It's got frequent releases, increased adoption, and full support is available, like Gmail today you use, right? It's a freemium, actually. It's actually pretty powerful software, actually, like Gmail, right? I mean, you don't have to pay for it, actually. Obviously, you see the ads and everything coming up. or LinkedIn or Twitter, right? I mean, these are free software, actually, right? I mean, you don't have to pay for Twitter. You don't have to pay for LinkedIn, right? But the good thing about these software is these are premium software, actually. This changes the way we're doing business today. 10 years ago, we didn't really have some of these ecosystem around us, right? Next slide. If you look at social media, search engines, and others, they already provide you. Next slide. If it provides you with these free software, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, as I mentioned. Next slide. Even in the enterprise, the adoption of open source and free software has grown significantly. Well, we just talked about consumer, right? The Googles and the Facebooks of the world. What about enterprises? If you look at ETL solutions, the extract, the transform, the load solutions, Talon and Pentaho, actually, which are open source and free software, it's about 15% adoption and 11% adoption, respectively. It's pretty powerful, actually. If you're competing against some of the big guys, or Microsoft and IBM and Informatica, they've actually grown significantly over the last 5 years and 3 years. So you can also see the adoption actually picking up, even in enterprises, for open source and free software, which has emerged. Next slide. And if you look at the adoption of databases, here is a recent survey we did around for different types of databases. And if you look at Oracle adoption, it's at 89%, SQL Server at 86%. Guess what? MySQL is still is not that behind. That's an open source kind of a platform at 47%. Postgres is another open source database platform at 17%. This is huge numbers. Now, these are big enterprises we're talking about. These are $500 million in revenue or more. These are not your small SMB companies we're talking about. These are very large organizations. Even the Fortune 1000 companies are using some of these open source and free software. And the reason is because of these budget crises which are hitting them, I guess, right? Next slide. Now, I guess subscription model can help you to get faster, get started faster, but no upfront cost, right? There's no upfront cost for it. There's no OPEX required, but it focuses on OPEX, but rather than CAPEX. So basically, you are only spending on the operational expenditure, OPEX, as opposed to the capital expenditure, right? And why use a subscription model? It's more reliable than your homegrown scripts, right? You don't have to pay $1 million to start using a subscription software, right? You can pay as you go, no upfront cost. It solves your data management issues right away. So today, if you have an issue of data management, you can go and grab these types of subscription models on softwares and get started right away. You don't really have to get management approvals to even do this, which is pretty cool, actually. Full support, budget required for obviously the operational expenditure, but the cons here is that you still require a budget for the operational expenses. You know, you don't require it for the capital expenditures. Now, this is a big trend we're seeing for organizations this year and in the next 2 years. Where people are going to start using more of this subscription-based model for data management. So this is something to seriously consider for your organization as well. Next slide. I guess, on the other hand, free software, which is called the freemium, requires no capital expenditure, no operational expenditure, and it's good to go, right? It's like it's free, like Facebook, right? I mean, you're using it for enterprise software. It's more reliable than your homegrown scripts. It doesn't need management approval, solves the issues. It's fully supported, can be upgraded. You don't lose anything in terms of, it only improves productivity. And more vendors now are starting to offer this free software. It's basically a zero budget model, which we talked about. Limitations here, maybe with the software, is that it's only, like, say, example. Masking for a certain software may only have 6-7 columns in a database, or may have some advanced features might not be available, some of these advanced features, right? But the good thing is it gets you started. You don't have to wait for a year. So if you ask any of the big guys, the sales cycle of software which you spend for more like $500,000 is 6 months to a year trying to get the software. Imagine if you're trying to put an order today, you'd probably get the software about a year later. That's not good enough for IT organizations to operate. You really have to start looking at some of these options right away. And these freemium software, free software, is where the real value can be brought into organizations going forward. Next slide. So I guess, you know, something to consider in terms of where you go from recommendation-wise, I guess there are no excuses to defer data management initiatives. Such as data masking or data archiving, test data management, just because you don't have a budget, right? You really can start looking at other options like subscription models and free software as well. Use free software and open source software instead of homegrown scripts. I definitely encourage that. You know, scripts are definitely an expensive kind of a model where you have to spend a lot of people resources and time and hardware resources, and in the long run, doesn't really work very well, right? It costs you more in time to management. I guess you can be a hero in your organization, I guess, by automating these data management tasks using free and open source software. It can help you lower the cost, improve efficiencies, and deliver business value, revenue, and competitive advantage. I think, you know, sometimes you don't really need to get directions from your organizations, from your top management, that you need to get this software, but you can also do it yourselves and say that, hey, by the way, we can start looking at these free software as well as some of these subscription software, which can really help us drive further innovation, better productiveness, and also improve the business. Use these software solutions like free and subscription to articulate the ROI and TCO benefits you're going to obtain over time. You go tell your management, I guess, right, that, hey, this is where you really benefit some of these solutions when you deploy it. Sometimes the management doesn't see the value in some of these solutions just because they can't visibly see these things, you know. They are hidden, like archiving. Like, they don't see that, actually, right? It's just hidden somewhere. But guess what? You can really save money in the hardware and software and make some of these application deployments simplified. I guess it's time for you to take on the next step on this new software model to stay competitive. And lower your data management cost. Next slide. And with that, I would like to thank you and hand it back to John.
Okay, Noel, that was outstanding. You caught us up and got us finished by the top of the hour. I appreciate that. And if I may, just apologize to everybody for the technical difficulties that we had earlier. But hopefully we got through everything in the time allocated. We do have some time for some questions. Deborah, if I could turn it over to you for that. Deborah?
Hey, great. Let's see. Feel free to put your questions in the chat box or raise your hand and we'll take that. Okay. Ah, here's a question. One of the questions that came in is, who is the competition in this space for Solix? As it relates to, I'm assuming, the freemium space for archiving and masking.
Probably Noel should take that.
Yeah, well, I mean, so general category-wise, right, archiving and masking and all, I mean, we have obviously IBM, Informatica, and obviously Solix is there. I mean, these are the leading companies today, what we see out there. And you know, I think every there's a different cost structures to it. And I guess Solix offers you this free software, which I think is where I think the differentiator lies, you know.
Okay, great. Thank you, Noel. Ah, another question. Why not keep all the data for analytics and just move to lower cost storage?
Right. So, go ahead, Noel. You do it.
No, that's fine.
Okay.
You were saying something.
Well, I was just going to say that essentially that's what we're doing by archiving. We're tiering from frequently used data to less frequently used data, and we're not remove. A lot of people sometimes think of archiving as you're taking it offline. It's not available anymore. You can't report on it, and that's a big misconception. I think it's what people figure. Okay, we're going to archive. You're going to take it off. It's almost like a tape, and now you got to go to Iron Mountain or something. That's actually not how the solution works. What the solution does is it actually moves data out of the production data set and moves it to a separate environment, but you still have the ability to query it, even using the native query tools that you may be comfortable with in PeopleSoft or Siebel or Oracle Business or something like that. So yes, I mean, I couldn't agree more. You do want to move your data to a separate platform where you can be driving enterprise analytics, and the system's quite capable of doing that.
Okay, and I think we have time for one more question. Ah, okay. What would be the benefit to my organization of the database archiving assessment that Solix is offering?
Okay, I'll take that one. What we have is a little sort of project that we have put out as an offer for anyone who attended this webinar, and we would recommend you all follow up on this. And essentially, what we'll be able to do is we'll be able to put some software on your database and analyze the impact of an archiving project. How much data can be reduced? And what sort of benefits might be driven as a result of that information. You know, in every application is going to be more or less archivable. Sometimes you're going to find a database that's going to have a lot of information that can be archived out of it, and you're going to see tremendous cost reduction and tremendous performance increase in your database and your overall application performance. Other times, databases, the application may work differently against the database, and you won't be able to reduce your data set as much. So a great step before launching an archiving project is to do an assessment and impact analysis to understand, okay, if I do this, what are the benefits that I can expect? And Solix, it'd be our pleasure to be invited to come in and help you with that assessment, and it's available to everyone participating today.
Great. Thank you, John, and thank you, Noel.